Today I'm going to talk about the dangerous ideas of the radical left according to the radical right. But I want to begin by discussing my latest favorite topic, space barons. You may have noticed that Jeff Bezos took a joyride to space on July 20th. Yeehaw! Bezos reportedly spent at least $5.5 billion on his four-minute space jaunt, the amount that it would cost to prevent 37 million people from starving or to secure COVID vaccines for 2 billion people in low-income countries. Here's what Jeff Bezos had to say about his trip.
And then I want to thank every Amazon employee and every Amazon customer, because you guys paid for all of this. So
Bezos fittingly blasted off in a phallic rocket ship, a perfect metaphor for the pissing contest between him, Richard Branson, and Elon Musk, three super rich white guys competing to see who can take colonialism, toxic masculinity, and climate racism to the next level, or should I say, the final frontier. The ultimate goal isn't to go where no one has gone before, but to colonize Mars with rich people once they've destroyed the Earth, leaving the rest of us in the ashes of late-stage capitalism. Not exactly the utopian future that Gene Roddenberry envisioned. This act of unparalleled narcissism has led some people to say that Bezos is reviving Marxism by proving the relevance of Marxist philosophy to late-stage capitalism. Uh-oh, that's the radical left alarm. I just mentioned Marxism, a dangerous ideology of the radical left. Fortunately, we have the illustrious Dr. Jordan Peterson, a psychology professor with no formal training in philosophy, to educate us about Marxist philosophy. Peterson explains that postmodern neo-Marxism is a dangerous totalitarian agenda that pushes for equality of outcome at any cost. Marxism is wrong because it fails to realize that wealth inequality is the mother of invention, a natural and necessary feature of any advanced civilization. In fact, we shouldn't be criticizing billionaires, we should be trying to become one of them, and above all, avoid becoming the dreaded beta male, who's barely better off than a lowly female. And by the way, those are the only two genders that Peterson recognizes. How do we know that wealth inequality is good? By looking at lobsters, probably one of our closest evolutionary ancestors. It's winner take all in the lobster world, just as it is in human societies, where the top 1% have as much loot as the bottom 50%. That same brutal principle of unequal distribution applies outside the financial domain. Indeed, anywhere that creative production is required. Think about it, just a handful of authors sell all the books. Those authors are clearly alpha lobsters. And by the way, if you become a beta male, your brain basically melts. If a dominant is badly defeated, its brain basically dissolves. Then it grows a new subordinate's brain, one more appropriate to its new lowly position. The top lobster, by contrast, parades his dominance around his territory. The female lobsters identify the top guy quickly and become irresistibly attracted to him. This is one brilliant strategy, and one used by females of many different species, including humans. Wow, and all this time I thought I didn't need a man. That must be because of my silly girl brain. Feminist philosopher Kate Mann reviewed Peterson's book and said that it's primarily directed towards a very particular audience, those predominantly white, straight, cis, and otherwise privileged men who fear being surpassed by their historical subordinates. Peterson doesn't support distributive justice because this would threaten the dominance of his target audience, privileged white men. Instead, he harnesses their insecurities to sell them the same advice that they could get for free from their parents, things like don't slouch and don't lie. In response to Mann's review, Peterson courageously threatened to sue her and cancel her before she got a chance to cancel him in the most insidious way possible with a book review in the Times Literary Supplement. Don't get me wrong, Peterson is definitely against cancel culture, which he describes as a female-specific form of bullying. But it's not cancel culture when he does it, because he's an alpha lobster. Canceling is what women do. That's just science. But if Peterson solved the problem of social inequality back in 2018 by proving that it's a good thing, then why are people still complaining about it? And why are people posting memes like this? Could Jeff Bezos have solved the problem of wealth inequality? This is what Timothy Noah asks in his article, Jeff Bezos, Space Marxist, in The New Republic. He argues that Bezos is reviving Marxism by admitting to stealing the surplus value of his workers' labor and spending it on space tourism. But what does he mean by surplus value? Surplus value is the value that workers add to a product after you deduct the cost of raw materials and equipment. Because Amazon pays its workers much less than the value of their labor, it's able to report a consistent profit margin of over $1 billion a month. The theft of the working class's surplus labor is exploitation. A handful of billionaires can exploit the majority of the population, the working class, because they own the means of production, the factories, warehouses, and infrastructure that provide almost all the jobs. They can use this monopoly to coerce workers into accepting low pay, long hours, and repetitive jobs that involve doing the same task over and over, day in and day out, like a machine. To quote Marx, "In the factory, we have a lifeless mechanism which is independent of the workers, who are incorporated into it as living appendages, the wearisome routine of endless drudgery in which the same mechanical process is ever repeated, is like the torture of Sisyphus. The burden of toil, like the rock, is ever falling back upon the worn-out drudge." The worker isn't a person, but a cog in the capitalist machine. We see a similar pattern today, with one Amazon worker explaining to a journalist, "We are machines, we are robots, we plug our scanner in, we're holding it, but we might as well be plugging it into ourselves. We don't think for ourselves. Maybe they don't trust us to think for ourselves as human beings." This routine alienates workers from their labor, which is soul-crushing drudgery, and from their very humanity, that is, the intrinsic desire that we all have to live a life of dignity and creativity. We don't voluntarily choose to do McJobs for $7.25 an hour. We have no choice because the alternative is either abject poverty or being trapped in the bureaucratic morass of the welfare system. This is what Marxists call wage slavery, our ineluctable dependence on wages for life. Working against your will for less than a living wage in a soul-sucking, repetitive job that alienates you from yourself and other people is the cost of the capitalist mode of production. This is how Bezos is proving Marx's theory of surplus value. He's stealing the surplus value of his workers' labor to launch space flights that his employees couldn't afford in 1,000 years. And then he's bragging about it. And he's also doing something that not even Marx could have anticipated. He's producing 100 times the greenhouse gas emissions of an airplane with every rocket that he launches into space. In other words, he's using his workers to build a doomsday machine. Bezos isn't harming people indiscriminately, though. Like most capitalist owners, he's hyper-exploiting historically disenfranchised groups. At Amazon, Black, Latinx, and female employees are underrepresented in the highest-paying jobs and overrepresented in the lowest-paying jobs. On top of this, Bezos is committing environmental racism as the CEO of Amazon and his new aerospace company, Blue Origin, both of which are highly unsustainable.
Environmental racism. It's about policies and practices that discriminate against communities of color by making them live near landfills, sewage plants, and other polluting facilities. And while poverty has a lot to do with it, the leading environmental justice expert told me this.
Racism trumps class. Even middle-income African Americans are more likely to live in more polluted neighborhoods.
In fact, one study found that Black Americans making $50,000 to $60,000 a year are more likely to live in polluted neighborhoods than white Americans who make just $10,000 a year.
These racial disparities are the focal point of critical race theory, which seeks to explain racism. Uh-oh, I just used another buzzword from the radical left, critical race theory. Fortunately, we have James Lindsay, a mathematician, to teach us about critical race theory. Who better to inform us about CRT than this obvious victim of racism, someone with real lived experience?
Critical race theory is then, in a very real sense, a counter-American revolution. But that's a positive, not a negative, to those who subscribe to the theory. The American experiment was given a 400-year tryout, and it doesn't work. So let's scrap it. That's what they believe. Is that what you believe? I'm going to guess that most of you don't. So how do we stop critical race theory before it infects the brains of too many decent Americans, especially young people, and turns us into something we have never been and shouldn't ever want to be? The answer is simple. Refuse to accept it. Don't be intimidated by the heads I win, tails you lose logic of this self-destructive, America-hating, anti-reality idea. Don't be bullied into thinking that you're racist when you know you're not, or that you're a victim when you know you're not. Defend yourself while you still can. I'm James Lindsay, founder of New Discourses for Prager University.
Lindsay explains that he's definitely not racist. CRT is racist because it says that all white people are racists. Critical race theorists say that people of color are being oppressed because of their race, but Lindsay says that he's the one being oppressed because of his race. Wait a minute, is Lindsay doing CRT? But he's against CRT. Okay, it's not CRT when he does it because he's a white man. When he does it, it's science. If Lindsay has solved the problem of racism, then why are people still complaining about it? Let's look at what Prudence Carter, an actual critical race theorist, has to say about it.
So critical race theory is a framework. It's a theoretical framework that was developed in... So critical race theory is a framework. It's a theoretical framework that was developed in the 1980s by legal scholars to help us understand how it is that structural and racial disparities endure in our society and how that is actually engendered in some of our laws and policies. And so the idea was to get us to think systemically as opposed to just thinking that racism manifests by individuals just mistreating each other, that there are actual structures in our society that create these different kinds of racial gaps and racial disparities economically, in terms of housing, in terms of education.
Wait, so CRT isn't all about how white people are racists? Next, you're going to tell me that white people are not the real victims of racism. Well, these are two very different perspectives. I'll let you decide whom to believe, a Black associate professor of education and sociology at Stanford University, or a white mathematician who's appeared on Joe Rogan's podcast twice. Another group that's disproportionately affected by capitalism is disabled people, who are marginalized by capitalism's principles of efficiency and streamlining, which come at the expense of inclusion and diversity. It's cheaper for corporations to build a one-size-fits-all workplace for non-disabled workers than to build an inclusive workplace that accommodates minority bodies. So that's what corporations do. They systematically exclude disabled people with non-inclusive design principles. That's why only 18% of disabled people have a job. Employers could try to provide disabled people with accommodations, but they usually don't. And when disabled workers try to sue their employers for discrimination, those employers usually countersue with a team of high-priced lawyers, and they usually win. The Americans with Disabilities Act has not been as effective as hoped at protecting disabled workers, and some critical disability theorists even say that it's been harmful. The workforce participation for disabled people is lower now than when the ADA was passed in 1990. Uh-oh. I used a buzzword from the radical left that the radical right doesn't even know about yet. Critical disability theory. But at this rate, James Lindsay will be denouncing CDT in a few months. Since CDT is so marginalized, even in academia, the radical right hasn't gotten a chance to read the Wikipedia entry on it and explain why it's hateful, un-American propaganda being used to indoctrinate your children into a Marxist pedophile ring run by liberal elites, or something like that. In reality, CDT is a critique of structural ableism that was developed by disabled scholars and activists. It calls on us to build a more inclusive culture. It's not a left-wing plot against the right. In fact, none of these theories are plots against conservatives. They're just academic schools of thought developed by the most marginalized academics to explain their experiences. There's nothing nefarious or conspiratorial about them, and they don't deserve to be canceled or vilified. If you read about CRT or CDT, you'll learn about things like housing inequality, racial incarceration, the prison industrial complex, racial reparations, affirmative action, universal design and accessibility, eugenics, disability pride, and intersectionality. And you can learn about all of these things for the low price of $3.99 at your local library. Do you have to agree with everything that critical race theorists and critical disability theorists say? Of course not. These theorists don't even agree with each other because academics don't agree about anything. We're literally always arguing and disagreeing with each other. That's just what philosophy is, the practice of argumentation and criticism. If you're arguing about a complex topic, you're probably doing philosophy. Congratulations. But if you refuse to even consider an idea, or worse yet, ban someone else from considering it, that's unphilosophical. That's actually dogmatic. I don't agree with James Lindsay, but do I refuse to engage with his ideas? Not according to the last 8 minutes of my talk. Instead of saying no to political theories, why not say yes to learning and reading about new things?
Please hang up and try again.
A rat done bit my sister Nell with Whitey on the moon. Her face and arms began to swell and Whitey's on the moon. I can't pay no doctor bills, but Whitey's on the moon. 10 years from now, I'll be paying still while Whitey's on the moon.